Dear Batch 23 students, today's class is on prognosis and treatment planning. We have seen about diagnosis in year 3. Welcome to year 4. So we'll start with other classes. So prognosis and treatment planning. What are the learning outcomes of prognosis and treatment planning? So the learning outcomes are: list 5 types of prognosis, explain the reason for proposed prognosis, develop an exact treatment plan, rank various treatment options based on the prognosis, and adjust treatment plan based on the patient's requirement. So what is prognosis? Prognosis is basically a prediction of the probable course and duration and outcome of a disease. So it is like a predicting how the disease will go, how the treatment will change the progression of the disease or outcome of the disease. That is what prognosis is. It is basically based on a general knowledge of the pathogenesis of the disease and the presence of the risk factor for the disease. The prognosis is established after the diagnosis is made, and it should be done before the treatment plan so that it will be helpful in guiding on a proper treatment so that you can achieve a better outcome after treatment. Basically, prognosis is a prediction of what will be the outcome of the treatment for this disease. That is what prognosis is. So we are going to predict how the course of the treatment and how the disease will progress. So basically it is based on the specific informations about the disease and the manner in which the treatment can be proceeded based on the disease. That is what prognosis is. It is going to help us with our diagnosis how the disease can progress and how to prevent it by treating. What are all the treatment can prevent the disease progression and bring back the diseased state to health. That is what prognosis is going to help us in. So it is also influenced by the clinician's previous experience with the treatment outcomes. So if the clinicians have experienced with the disease and they have already treated such diseases and outcomes what they have got, based on that only we are going to give our prognosis and treatment planning. This is basically achieved by the controlled studies, randomized clinical trials, meta-analysis and systematic analysis done previously by previous dentists who have already done such diseases, treated such diseases, and they have already posted their comments on how the prognosis and how the outcome will be for that specific disease if a specific treatment has been given. That is what the basic idea is. So based on their knowledge, whatever knowledge they have given to us, we are going to utilize that knowledge to predict the future of the disease, how the disease can proceed, or how we can control or prevent the progression of the disease. That is what the idea of using prognosis. So prognostic factor versus risk factor. So what is the difference between prognostic factor and risk factor? Risk factors are factors which is present which can increase or modify the progression of the disease. That is what risk factors are. So the prognostic factors are characteristically, it predicts the outcome of the disease. So in some cases the risk and the prognostic factor are going to be the same. For example, if the patient is a diabetic patient or a smoker patient, we already know it is a risk factor, and this risk factor, with the help of this risk factor, we can predict how the disease will progress too. If the patient is having a periodontal disease along with diabetes and smoking, we can able to predict how the disease progression will be. So risk factors are before the disease comes. If the patient is having the factor, the patient have the probability of getting the disease. That is what risk factors going to do to us. Whereas prognosis is after the disease happens, what is the role of these risk factors in progression of the disease. That is what prognostic factor. So it is important to note that determination of a prognosis is a dynamic process. It is not going to be a static process, because it is not, we are not going to do it once and we are not going to proceed with that prognosis base, and we are going to continue with the treatment. It is a dynamic process. Each and every time when the patient comes, there will be modifications in the progression of the disease. There will be some betterments or worsening happens because of the treatment. So based on the outcome, what we have achieved after the treatment, and based on the outcome we achieved by modifying the disease progression, the prognosis also will modify, will change. So the prognosis initially assigned should be re-evaluated after completing all the phases of therapy, so including the periodontal maintenance. So it is a dynamic process. We are going to do it multiple times. It is not only once we are going to do. The prognosis is going to be a dynamic process. For example, today you may give a good prognosis. For the next visit, the patient might have shown an aggressive activity of disease, which may change the prognosis from good to a fair or a poor. Right? So what are the types of prognosis? Based on that, the types of prognosis have been classified as diagnostic prognosis, therapeutic prognosis, and prosthetic prognosis. So what is this? The diagnostic prognosis is based on the diagnosis, what we have achieved, and the course of the disease without treatment, how the disease can progress without any treatment. That is what diagnostic prognosis. For this disease, the disease will progress in such and such way without, if we are not going to treat the disease. That is what the anticipated future for the disease. That is what diagnostic prognosis. Whereas a therapeutic prognosis is a prognosis given when a disease is happening and we treat the disease, what will be the outcome. That is what therapeutic prognosis is. So when a periodontal treatment is given, what will be the course of the disease, how the course of the disease may change after the treatment. That is what the prediction we are going to give with the treatment. So it is called as therapeutic prognosis. Whereas prosthetic prognosis is factors like when a patient is periodontally diseased and patient requires some prosthetic rehabilitation, or patient is already having a prosthesis on his mouth. So we have to evaluate whether the prosthesis can able to bear, the periodontium can able to bear the prosthesis, or whether the periodontium will be stable after the prosthetic management. That is what prosthetic prognosis is. So we are going to predict how the periodontium will be if a prosthesis have been given, or what will be the status of a periodontium if there is a prosthesis already present. So based on that, it is given as prosthetic prognosis. So other ways of classifying prognosis is overall and individual tooth prognosis. Overall prognosis is a concern with the entire dentition, a full mouth scenario of how the prognosis will be. This is based on the patient age, severity of the disease, systemic factors, smoking, presence of local factors, patient's compliance, and prosthetic possibilities. We have to evaluate all these things to give a overall prognosis. So followed by overall prognosis, we will go to individual tooth prognosis. We can't give an individual tooth prognosis for a overall or a overall prognosis for an individual. Why the difference is, an individual tooth prognosis will vary when compared to a overall prognosis. For example, if the patient have been given with a poor overall prognosis, but a single tooth in the oral cavity may be in a questionable state which cannot be saved, that has to be removed. That in such scenarios, we cannot give a poor prognosis for the individual tooth also. The individual tooth will get a questionable prognosis rather than a poor prognosis. Right? So coming on to the grading of prognosis, based on the individual tooth, there will be grading of prognosis. There are different classifications based on the authors. Some have classified the grades based on the mortality of the tooth, and they have classified into excellent, good, fair, poor, questionable, and hopeless. And others have done some other different way of classifying, like favorable, unfavorable, questionable, hopeless, other author have classified it as good, fair, poor, alone. So according to current sir, we follow whatever is based on the mortality of the tooth. So the prognosis classification or grading based on the mortality of the tooth, it is classified into excellent, good, fair, poor, questionable and hopeless. So how we are going to grade it? Basically, an excellent prognosis is given when there is no disease. There will not be any bone loss, the gingival condition will be in an excellent state, the patient will be very cooperative and there will not be any systemic or environmental factors to compensate our prognosis. In such cases, there is no disease. In such cases, we can give excellent prognosis. A good prognosis is given when there is a disease, for example, a gingival disease, where there is no periodontal support is lost. The periodontal support is adequate, the periodontal support is stable. Once we control the etiological factors, we can able to maintain the patient in a good health. Then such cases we will give it as good prognosis. So good prognosis is control of etiological factor and adequate periodontal support ensures the tooth will be easily to be maintained by the patient and the clinician. Whereas fair prognosis, in case of loss of attachment, when approximately 25% of attachment loss happens with or without furcation involvement. Class 1 furcation involvement, whereas the furcation involvement is less than the adequate bone support, which there is some amount of mobility and presence of some environmental or systemic factors. All these combines together to form a fair prognosis if a patient having an attachment loss of 25%. So attachment loss is calculated from the cemento-enamel junction to the apex of the root. So that is attachment apparatus. So from CEJ to the apex of the root, if about 25% of the attachment has been lost, then the patient should be prognosed as fair prognosis. Next is poor prognosis. Poor prognosis when there is 50% of attachment loss happens with or without a class 2 furcation involvement. A location on depth of the furcation involvement which makes the maintenance possible but with some difficulties. We can able to maintain the furcation but with some difficulties because of the class 2 furcation. So poor prognosis will be given for patients with moderate to advanced bone loss with tooth mobility and presence of systemic or environmental factor. Next is questionable prognosis when there is more than 50% of bone loss or attachment loss happens, which results in poor crown to root ratio, poor root forms, either class 2 or class 3 furcation involvement with grade 2 mobility and increased root proximities. So patients with advanced bone loss, grade 2 and grade 3 furcation involvement, tooth mobility, inaccessible areas and presence of systemic and environmental factors are classified under questionable prognosis. Hopeless prognosis is when the patient having inadequate attachment, the tooth doesn't have any attachment or in an advanced state of bone loss which directly goes for extraction. If the tooth is indicated for extraction, then it should be prognosed as hopeless tooth. So before coming on to the prognosis, what are all the factors to be considered when determining a prognosis? When we are planning to determine a prognosis, what are all the factors we need to consider? We need to basically consider the local factor, environmental factor, patient related factor and clinician related factor. All these together we are going to do the prognosis. It is not only one factor we are going to take into account, it is all the factors. So we have to evaluate all the factors to come to a prognosis. It is a combination of all these things. So if only one factor is there, the prognosis will be better. If two factors joins together, the prognosis will go worse. If all factors are present, then the prognosis will go still more worse. That is what the idea of evaluating the factors when considering or determining a prognosis. So what are all the factors we are going to see? The overall clinical factors, systemic environmental factor, local factors, anatomical factors, and prosthetic and restorative factors. So basically it is divided into three groups. One is local or environmental factors, patient related factor, and clinician related factor. Under local environmental factor, we are going to see the local plaque, calculus, subgingival restorations, and anatomical factors like enamel pearls, root concavities, root proximities, furcation involvement, tooth mobility, or short roots. When it comes to patient related factor, we have to see the age of the patient, patient's medical conditions, patient's genetic factor, patient's habit, patient cooperation, and patient economic status. With the help of this only, we can able to prognose. If the patient economic status is poor, he cannot able to afford for a surgical management, then you cannot proceed to a surgery. You cannot control the disease. Then your prognosis should go down. Clinician factor, the diagnostic skill of the clinician, the treatment knowledge, and the clinical ability of the clinician, and patient motivation and education by the clinician. All these will determine the prognosis. If all these are present, the prognosis will go worse. So what is the relation between diagnosis and prognosis? Basically, we have already seen diagnosis. We know there are only two diagnoses. Basically, diagnosis is only two. One is gingivitis and periodontal disease. So we have already seen the classification of periodontal disease in previous classes and gingival disease in previous classes, right? The classification is already done. So based on the classification, we know there are some gingival diseases, there are some periodontal diseases. So what is the relation between diagnosis and prognosis is when there is a gingival disease, the prognosis will be better. So the prognosis for patient with gingival disease will be given as an excellent to good prognosis, provided when we can able to eliminate all the irritating factors, local predisposing factors, maintain the gingival contour, and when the patient can able to maintain a good oral hygiene, then you can able to directly give a excellent to good prognosis. Whereas in periodontitis, if the patient is having a periodontitis, your prognosis will be going to a next level. It will be either fair or poor. For example, and based on the severity of the periodontitis, if it is a slight to moderate periodontitis, you can even give a good prognosis, provided the patient can able to control the inflammation with proper oral hygiene measures, and you can able to remove all the local plaque retentive factors, then you can give a good prognosis. Otherwise, if there is a moderate to severe bone loss or severe periodontitis, then your prognosis will go more towards fair or a poor prognosis. So that is the role of your diagnosis with prognosis. So based on your diagnosis, your prognosis will change. So a proper diagnosis is required, and a thorough, careful examination should be done before coming on to a prognosis. Based on your proper accurate diagnosis only, you can provide a prognosis. Based on your prognosis only, you have to plan a treatment. So the treatment should be made to improve your prognosis. The treatment plan should be made to improve the prognosis. When one, for example, if you are giving a prognosis of good, your treatment plan should be in such a way that your treatment should change the good prognosis to an excellent prognosis. That is what the role of treatment planning with the help of prognosis, right? So the diagnosis and prognosis will change once the treatment is done. For example, for gingivitis patient, you give a prognosis of good. Once the treatment is done, when the patient can able to maintain, from gingivitis the diagnosis changes to health. From good prognosis, the prognosis changes to a excellent prognosis. So it is a dynamic process. The diagnosis will change, the prognosis will change once the treatment is done, right? So the key to success for a proper prognosis or a proper outcome of your treatment is doing a proper evaluation of the case and getting on to a good diagnosis. Based on the diagnosis, you have to come to a good prognosis. Based on your prognosis, you have to plan the treatment and execute the treatment. Right? That is the best key to a successful periodontal therapy. So next we'll go on with treatment planning. So what is treatment planning? Basically, treatment planning is a stepwise treatment, how we are going to proceed with the treatment in step by step for the particular patient based on the diagnosis and prognosis what we achieved. That is what treatment plan is. So there is a sequence should be followed in treating a patients. Starts with phase 1 therapy, phase 2 therapy, phase 3 therapy, phase 4 therapy, like that, right? So whatever the patient comes, we always starts with an emergency phase. So it should be start with an emergency phase followed by a non-surgical phase. Once the emergency phase is treated, then you have to treat the cause. Why we want to treat the cause is to prevent the progression of the disease. Once you remove the cause, the progression of the disease will stop. Then we can achieve or try to achieve the regain of whatever has been lost. That is what the next phase is, the surgical phase. So basically the treatment plan follows an emergency phase followed by phase 1, which is non-surgical phase, or a etiotropic phase. We are going to remove the cause, or causative therapy, where we are going to remove the cause for the disease, then reevaluate the status. So each and every phase you have to reevaluate. The maintenance phase will come inside between each and every phase. Once you do phase 1, do reevaluate the phase 1 therapy, then move on to phase 2 therapy. If the patient requires a surgical phase, do a surgical phase. After surgical phase, you have to come back to maintenance phase to reevaluate the result of surgical phase. What is the effect of surgical phase happens? Then you have to move on to phase 3 or restorative phase. Once you done the restorative phase, you have to come back again to maintenance phase, reevaluate the maintenance therapy. So maintenance therapy should be done after each and every phase of periodontal therapy. So basically maintenance phase is important for a good outcome of treatment. So what are all the treatment we are going to do during emergency phase? We'll treat any type of pain, extraction of all the hopeless teeth, and if the patient is having any abscess, draining of the abscess should be done in emergency phase. Once the emergency phase is completed, then we move on to phase 1 therapy. The phase 1 therapy is also called as a non-surgical periodontal therapy or a cause-related therapy, where we are going to eliminate the etiology for the disease. The main objective of this phase 1 is to eliminate and prevent the reformation of bacterial deposit onto the tooth surface and root surface. So what are all the things we are going to do in phase 1 is includes patient diet counseling, oral hygiene instructions, removal of all plaque retentive factors, either it may be a natural factor or an iatrogenic factor, then do a proper supragingival and subgingival scaling, root planing, occlusal corrections, antimicrobial therapy, chemical plaque control agents, correction of restorations and prostheses, and excavation of caries or restorations, minor orthodontic movements, patient educations on various plaque control measures like brushing technique, flossing technique, interdental cleansing aids, and you have to give a counseling on habit modifications and smoking cessations. All this should compress in your phase 1 therapy. Once you finish the phase 1 therapy, you have to reevaluate the phase 1 therapy. So this reevaluation will be done based on the type of diagnosis. The reevaluation may be after 1 week or 2 weeks or 21 days or 3 months, based on the type of diagnosis you are giving. For example, if the patient is having a gingivitis, so you are basically going to reevaluate the epithelial healing if it is gingivitis. So you have to call back the patient within 1 week. because the epithelial healing will happen within 1 week time. So you have to call back the patient in 1 week time. If the patient is having some amount of connective tissue breakdown, then you have to wait for 21 days, 2 weeks to 3 weeks, then only you can call back the patient to reevaluate the connective tissue breakdown status. So the reevaluation of phase one will, the time period for reevaluation of phase one will differ based on the diagnosis of the patient. So what are all the things we are going to do during the reevaluation of phase one is rechecking of the oral agent status, gingival status, probing pocket depth, attachment levels, and local factors and caries. All these things should be reevaluated during the reevaluation of phase one. Once this is done, then we have to decide on whether to go for phase two. So phase two therapy, when we will go for phase two therapy, when we can able to contain the defect and prevent the progression of the disease, and we want to regain the tissue or bone whichever has been lost. If we are planning to regain it back to the normal position, then we have to go for phase two therapy. Or if we couldn't able to control the disease progression because of aggressive disease or more deeper, which cannot be done with the help of a non-surgical therapy, then you have to move to phase two therapy. So phase two therapy basically a surgical phase, all various types of surgeries from access flap surgery to implant surgery and endodontic surgery should comes under phase two therapy. So what is the indication for this phase two therapy? Where there is an impaired access for scaling and rippling, when we cannot able to completely contain the defect with non-surgical phase, then we have to move on to the surgical phase. For example, if the pocket depth is more deeper, where we cannot able to access the deeper part of the pocket with non-surgical therapy, then we have to open the flap, gain access for the deepest part of the disease and clean out the region with scaling and root planing. That is one of the indication for your phase two therapy. Or you can do a phase two therapy for cases like crown lengthening, or once you able to contain the defect, you want to regenerate back, you want to bring the lost tissue back, then you have to go for surgical management by placing bone graft so that you can bring back whatever has been lost. Then you have to think about phase two therapy. If nothing was there, if any of this is not there, when you can able to completely arrest the disease, the patient can able to maintain without any complications the oral hygiene, then you don't need to go for phase two therapy. If the patient cannot able to maintain the oral hygiene after phase one therapy because of deeper pocket or irregular bone margins, then you have to think about phase two therapy to remove it or regain it to the normal position. So what are all the contraindications for phase two is when the patient is uncooperative. So when the patient cannot able to maintain the oral hygiene after phase one therapy, then you should not proceed to phase two therapy. Or if the patient is having some habits or any systemic conditions which cannot be controlled, or patient cannot able to quit the habit, then don't proceed to surgical phase. You have to keep maintaining with the maintenance phase and phase one therapy, repeatedly doing phase one and maintenance therapy to maintain the patients, but you cannot proceed to a surgical phase. Once surgical therapy is done, you have to go to reevaluation of surgical phase, where you are going to again reevaluate the oral agent status, gingival inflammation, probing depth and attachment level. But here we are going to do a surgery, so the response or reevaluation to surgical phase should be done minimum of 21 days later. It should not be done immediately after 1 week we are going to probe. No, definitely we cannot probe because the attachment will not happen within that 1 week time. So minimum attachment, the connective tissue attachment, takes 21 days for it to reattach. Even after 21 days, it will be like a long junctional epithelium. If you probe, you are going to interfere with the healing. So the reevaluation of the surgical therapy should be prolonged up to 3 months based on the type of surgery what you are going to do. once phase 2 and re-evaluation of phase 2 is done, you can proceed to phase 3. Phase 3 is which is final restorations. If you have done any temporary restoration in phase 1 or you have done any orthodontic tooth movement or you have done any endodontic treatment in phase 2, then your final restoration and final prosthesis should be done in phase 3. Once you finish the phase 3, again you have to re-evaluate the phase 3 with maintenance phase. Again, during re-evaluation, you have to recheck the oral agent status, gingival status, restoration status and attachment level. So the maintenance should includes after each and every phase of periodontal therapy. So we have shown a periodontal treatment decision tree so that you can able to come to an idea of how to go about periodontal evaluation. So if a periodontal patient comes to your clinic, if there is no attachment loss, if the patient is gingivitis, do a proper prophylaxis and re-evaluate the patient and put the patient in maintenance for repeated scaling and re-evaluation. So this will be done every 6 months once. If the patient is having attachment loss, then you have to do a phase 1 therapy, re-evaluate the phase 1 therapy and proceed to phase 2. Once you do the phase 2 therapy, then you have to move on to phase 3 and maintenance. So finally, we are coming on to the maintenance phase. Maintenance phase, I have already told you that the maintenance phase should be included after each and every phase. After phase 1, after phase 2, after phase 3, you are going to do maintenance phase. So the maintenance phase starts immediately after phase 1 therapy. Once you finish the phase 1 therapy, the maintenance protocol starts. So we have to maintain the patient on every therapy, phase 1 therapy, phase 2 therapy and phase 3 therapy. So it is a process of a long term process. You are going to keep the patient for the rest of the life under maintenance therapy after your initial treatment. So the patient should be requested to come back every 6 months if the patient doesn't have any complications. If the patient is having any complications like periodontal disease or any systemic disease or environmental factor, then your maintenance schedule should be once in 3 months or once in 4 months. So what are all the things we will do in maintenance phase? Basically, the maintenance phase comprises of 1 hour of treatment. An hour of treatment which includes examination, treatment and scheduling of next appointment. So the examination process almost takes approximately 14 minutes, which includes update of the medical history, re-evaluation of the oral agent status, gingival changes, changes in the pocket depth, changes in the mobility, changes in the occlusion, level of dental caries, changes in the restoration and prosthesis. All these things should be re-evaluated and examined again, and you have to come to a diagnosis again with the examinations. So this will be approximately taken 14 minutes, followed by treatment. The treatment which includes scaling, root planing, polishing and proper oral hygiene reinforcement with plaque control should be done. So this approximately takes 36 minutes. The treatment phase will take 36 minutes, including scaling, polishing and reinforcement of oral hygiene maintenance and plaque control measures, then followed by at approximately 10 minutes of scheduling the next appointment. So you have to complete the treatment with scheduling the next appointment. Based on your diagnosis and treatment, you have to decide when the patient should be recalled. For example, if the patient come back with a state of gingivitis, you are going to do the treatment and you are going to put the patient in 3 months interval. If the patient, there is an progression of disease from gingivitis to periodontitis, then you have to increase your recall visit more frequently to further evaluate the periodontal status. For the progression of disease should be evaluated more frequently if there is increase in the disease status. So the maintenance of health depends on the disease prevention, meticulous daily patient home care and patient adheres to the professional recall maintenance at a regular interval. So basically we have immediate goal, intermediate goal and long term goal. The immediate goal is to eliminate all the infections and inflammation process that cause periodontal disease and other oral diseases. That is the immediate goal. The intermediate goal is to reconstruct the patient dentition to a healthy state. From disease to bring back to health is the intermediate goal, whereas the long term goal is to maintain the health for a prolonged period of time. So the immediate goal is to eliminate the disease, the intermediate goal is to bring back to health, but the long term goal is to maintain the health for a prolonged period of time. That is our long term goal. The long term goal is maintenance of health through prevention and professional supportive therapy. The long term goal is set and both the patient and clinician works towards the long term goal from the very first day. So we have seen the different treatment plans and sequence of treatment plans. So I have given as a chart the periodontal treatment sequence. So the treatment sequence starts with periodontal evaluation followed by non-surgical therapy, re-evaluation of non-surgical phase, then followed by surgical phase, re-evaluation of surgical phase and periodontal maintenance. If the patient requires a restorative phase, then you have to do a restorative phase, re-evaluation of restorative phase and then maintenance phase. So this is a sample treatment timeline. So if the patient has come to your clinic, so it starts with periodontal evaluation and you move on to non-surgical periodontal therapy, phase 1 therapy, then maintenance therapy. Periodontal re-evaluation maintenance should start after the phase 1 therapy, then proceed to surgical therapy, maintenance therapy, surgical therapy if required a second time, again surgical therapy, maintenance therapy, restorative therapy, maintenance therapy, maintenance therapy, maintenance therapy. So once you complete all your treatment, the patient still should follow the maintenance therapy. The supportive therapy should be there every 3 months or 6 months based on the patient prognosis. The treatment, the supportive therapy should go on for life. That is what the idea of doing a proper periodontal treatment. So to conclude, the ultimate goal for every patient is to bring his or her mouth to a state of health and maintain it for a long time. After the proper diagnosis and prognosis have been established, the treatment plan is made to coordinate all the treatment procedures to create a well-functioning dentition in a healthy periodontal environment. So a proper diagnosis should be followed by prognosis evaluation before the treatment plan and to execute a proper treatment to achieve a desired long-term outcome for the periodontal therapy. Right? So basically we are going to do a proper diagnosis and the diagnosis, based on the diagnosis we have to achieve a proper prognosis. Based on the prognosis, plan the treatment, execute the treatment and bring back the patient disease to health. Right? Thank you.